Welcome, everyone. My name is Chris Lukolio, and I'm the digital country lead for UNCDF in Uganda. I'm very excited to invite you all today, to have you all today in this session as part of the Singapore FinTech Festival. We have a very exciting session for you today, and this one is focusing on the foundations of an inclusive digital economy. So we have speakers from various countries, and I will be inviting the Honorable Permanent Secretary from the Ministry of ICT and National Guidance in Uganda to give a welcome note. We will then have a short video from a keynote speaker from Estonia, Mr. Kaivats Martens, and then after that, we will have a panel session on the very same topic. So once again, very, very good to have you all in this session, and looking forward to an exciting session. So at this point, allow me to invite Mr. Vincent Bajire, Permanent Secretary of the Ministry of ICT and National Guidance in Uganda, to give us his welcome remarks. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Chris, for your remarks. Fellow panelists, participants, I take this opportunity to welcome you all to this panel or to this event. And at the same time, I thank the conveners of this very important event, the Singapore FinTech Festival, that gives us an opportunity to share ideas and knowledge with a view of improving humanity, and specifically in the area of digital inclusion. I welcome you all and look forward to the deliberations. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Honorable Bajire. Actually, at this point, let me ask you to, I believe you have some remarks prepared for us, some welcome remarks, overall on, again, foundational infrastructure in Uganda, and, you know, pointing to the work that you have done, that the government of Uganda has done in putting in place the infrastructure needed to build an inclusive digital economy. So at this point, I will invite you to share with us those remarks. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris, for the opportunity once again. Government of Uganda, like many governments across the world, takes the issue of digital inclusion very serious. And in so doing, we have prepared and worked on an enabling environment to guarantee that we deploy infrastructure in an inclusive way across the entire country, working within government, government itself deploying infrastructure. Government has, as of now, deployed 4,000 kilometers of optic fiber to make sure that a number of our offices across the country are connected to the internet. But in addition to that, we have the private sector, MTN, Airtel, among others, playing a critical role in deploying infrastructure across the country for purposes of providing connectivity to the citizens. And as a result, we have been able to automate a number of government services to ensure that the citizens indeed do receive services as fast as possible. And in so doing, we have learned some lessons. We've seen that there are some interventions that we need to undertake as government. And as a result, we have created a framework for infrastructure sharing to ensure that the cost of a connectivity to an ordinary citizen is as affordable as possible. So what we are doing is encouraging we in government as well as the private sector to share the infrastructure that they have, as opposed to various agencies and or private operators or actors deploying infrastructure in the same areas at high costs and then transfer the cost onto the consumer. And this we are doing largely because we have decided that all services that government offers, the government of Uganda offers, should be automated. And as a result, we think it's imperative that the cost remains as affordable as possible. Beyond that, we have taken on the responsibility to create our own national data center as a country, to see to it that all the automation that we are doing remains within the country and the data is accessed as fast as possible. Additionally, we are now in the process of creating what we have referred to as an enterprise bus, an integration platform where all systems within government can speak to each other. In other words, if you're paying taxes to the Uganda Revenue Authority, the banks should speak with the Revenue Authority. The National ID Register should be able to speak to universities that admit people. The people issuing passports and or driver's license should be able to tap into this national database of the national ID so that citizens receive services as seamlessly as possible and with ease. And in so doing, we are confident that as a country, we shall be active actors or participants in the knowledge economy. I thank you, Chris.
Thank you so much, Honorable Vajire, and many thanks again to you for taking the time to participate in this session, and also many thanks to all our panel members and all the participants who are tuned into this session. I'm now going to invite, we have remarks prepared from Mr. Kaivat Martens, who could not be with us today, but sent a short video, which we will now play for our attendees, and then move on to the panel session after that. So let me invite our technical team to help us play this video. Thank you so much.
Hello, everybody. This is Martin from a very cold morning here in Estonia. I'm sorry that I cannot be with you, but because of the pandemic, you probably all get it. So, my name is Martin Kaivats. I'm the National Digital Advisor for the Government of Estonia, and I've been asked here today to talk to you about the different innovations that Estonia has undergone in order to build actually a digital society that is inclusive and is constantly adaptable and ready for different changes, whatever different technologies are up and coming. And if we look at, for example, this year, in the springtime, all of us needed to change the way we behave and act because the physical infrastructure actually became obsolete. Then how to build ecosystems that are constantly adaptive and ready to change? So in order to start the story, a short story about 10 minutes about the journey we've taken here in Estonia, I want you to show you one place. Basically, this building that is over there, St. Olaf's Church, it used to be the tallest building in the world, just before the Eiffel Tower. So for 150 years, the tallest building in the world was in this small little town of 440,000 people. And the main lesson learned in building a digital society here in Estonia is actually that this digital transformation and this change that we are constantly talking about actually has got very, very little to do with different technologies. But it's mostly about building a mindset and culture ready to adopt new things. And this is especially true in the case of public sector, because as you probably all know, civil servants are used to dealing with business as usual, and opening their minds and in order to change the different processes is relatively difficult. And as Frank Zappa once put it, minds are like parachutes. They only work when they're open. But in order to explain the Estonian narrative in a nutshell, you need to understand that every digital society, regardless of their ideology or their economical status, has to solve three different problems. We need to solve digital identity, we need to solve a coherent way of data exchange, and thirdly, we need to have a way to solve data integrity. And going step by step, identity is both the cultural thing. So I have my cultural identity. I'm from Estonia, but I originate from the two islands here in Estonia. This is very important to me. And probably this kind of a cultural identity is important for everybody. But then there is also digital identity. Digital identity means that all of us actually need to have a way to securely prove who they are in the digital space. While as in many places, digital identity has been regarded as a kind of a political issue, somehow affecting their cultural identity, then important to understand that digital identity is not a political question. It's an engineering problem that needs to be solved. And in order to have this kind of infrastructure place, we need to work hard to actually overcome these issues in order to have a reliable and trustworthy and private and secure infrastructure in place. We cannot do it without having a secure digital identity. Secondly, we need to have a way of coherently exchanging data. And here there are many different models. So depending on your worldview, ideology and capacity, you could always choose the Chinese version, which is a kind of centralized governmental control version. This is an architecture where all of the data is centralized and also the different competencies and know-how is concentrated. So basically the power goes to very few people. You could potentially choose the American model, which is, I call it quasi-decentral, where large-scale companies, a few of them, are actually handling all of the data. Or there's also a third alternative, which is a distributed model, such as European Union is doing with GDPR, where the aspiration is for every citizen to become the owner of their own data. And of this model, Estonia is one of the prime examples to actually show how the ownership of data actually works in practice. In Estonia, we have solved the data exchange problem with the open source data exchange layer called X-Road, which actually helps us to unify in a coherent way how government entities are exchanging data with each other. And thirdly, we need to build a data integrity layer. What this means is that no third party can change the data without the trail. In Estonia, we started experimenting with blockchain solutions in 2008, April, and since 2012, all governmental information systems log files have been blockchained, which gives us a thorough layer of transparency. It gives the foundations of trust. And this is key, because if you do something in the digital space, there is always a data trail. And if you're the owner of your own data, then you need to know who has been looking at your data, when and why. And this blockchain architecture is the one that actually helps us to move this forward. And currently, Estonian government is working hard on implementing other new sorts of technologies, such as artificial intelligence. For example, currently we have about 46 different narrow AI applications live in the public sector, which are already providing value in terms of cost effectiveness, but also the quality of services. With AI, we are hoping to build a governance architecture that is actually seamless, transparent, and trustworthy. And hopefully within the next, let's say 10 years, we can automate roughly 95% of all sorts of bureaucratic routines so that we can actually provide value to the citizens rather than control or punish them. So these are the few of the thoughts from a very cold morning here in Estonia. Hopefully there was some ideas for you, and hopefully it's much better weather in Singapore than here, because currently it's like, you cannot see it. It's relatively minus something, and my hands are rather cold. So have a inspiring dialogue in Singapore, and really hoping that these ideas got you thinking. And if you're looking for anything else, check out eestonia.com. There is a lot of different case studies and information about different use cases and ways Estonia has solved it. And very importantly, most of this know-how, knowledge and expertise and software is actually open source. So you can download it and start kicking the tires and checking out and building your own ecosystem, regardless the amount of money you have in order to build an ecosystem. So thank you for me, and hopefully you are having fruitful discussions in Singapore, and over and out. Thank you.
Many, many thanks there to Mr. Martin Kaivert. Once again, giving his remarks via video, but, we are seeing a pandemic, but it hasn't prevented us from communicating. And I hope you all appreciated the change in flavor that came with Mr. Kaivert's video. Allow me now to invite our panelists, who I'm going to introduce one by one, and then they will have a chance to talk about themselves briefly, what they do. First and foremost, let me introduce Mike McCaffrey. He's the Regional Digital Hub Manager for East and Southern Africa for UNCDF. Mike, you're welcome.
Thank you.
And Mike will be our moderator for this panel. Also on this panel, we will have the Honorable Permanent Secretary for the Ministry of ICT and National Guidance in Uganda, Mr. Vincent Bajire, who you heard from. Mr. Bajire, you're welcome. And then we will have Jane Mugenyi from MTN Uganda. MTN is a major MNO, mobile network operator in Uganda. Jane, you are very welcome to this panel. And lastly, we have Mr. Harish Natarajan from the World Bank, also on this panel. Mr. Harish, you are very welcome. Let me hand over to Mike McCaffrey to moderate this panel. Mike, over to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Chris. It's an exciting opportunity to moderate this panel. It's a very important topic. We often talk about the importance of inclusive digital economies and the things that can bring for countries around the world. We talk about sectors of new growth that are going to grow GDPs, that are going to create jobs. We talk about the ability for digital to create new clean ways of developing our economies. And we talk about the ability of digital platforms to create more equal societies, to enable more people access to core services, access to information. So there's a lot of potential, and I don't think that is too highly debated. But the question really is, how do we get there? How do we get there in the Global South, where we recognize that these digital economies are supported by foundations of infrastructure that enable them? And so today we have distinguished speakers here to really talk about what are some of the key elements of that infrastructure, to talk about specifically the story in Uganda, some of the success that's been had there from both a private and a public sector perspective, as well as some of the global perspective from other countries around the world in the Global South that have been have embarked on this journey, and hopefully have some lessons to share with the rest of us. I want to start the panel off by talking about the video that we just saw. And one of the major emphases in the video was really talking about a digital ID system. And in Uganda, they've been also implementing a digital ID system over in the recent years. And so I just wanted to ask a general question to all the panelists. In terms of a digital ID system being foundational infrastructure, what then are the most exciting innovations, most exciting products and services that enables, that we can build upon it? So I'll just open that up and see if any of the panelists want to respond.
Okay, so maybe let me start it off. So I think in terms of the services which ID can enable, I think fundamentally, if you look at it, the reasons for financial exclusion, it's broadly one of three, right? So the cost to serve for the private service providers, the cost to access for individuals and businesses, and then lastly, what is the utility for them from availing these services. And I think digital ID and ID enhancements can address the first two very squarely by enabling an individual to reliably authenticate and verify themselves at a remote location, either at either in person, at say an agent location, or being able to do it online once the capabilities increase. And this is a direct implication on the cost to serve, because it really cuts down the cost related to verifying the customer, which is required as part of the financial sector norms. And similarly, so that is what is one of the most fundamental kind of benefits which can come, particularly noting it from the financial sector side. The other services which could be enabled is any remote service you look at, interacting with the government or interacting with any other individual on a commercial for a commercial transaction, you are required to identify yourself. And the digital ID creates more opportunities for you to verify and authenticate yourself remotely, digitally, which is all the more critical in this current context. And also for things like if you want to do things remotely, you might want to consent for certain data to be shared, which opens up more possibilities for you. All of that requires some form of consent, authentication, and verification. So I think all of that becomes enabled. So I think in some sense, one can say that the entire benefits of the digital economy can become will be unlocked once we have a good functioning ID system, and particularly one which is digital. Thank you.
Thank you, Harish. Jane or Honorable Bajiri, did you want to comment on the situation in Uganda and what this is kind of paving the way for in the future?
If I may, and then maybe Jane will follow suit. I can't say that we, as government, and of course working with the private sector, are making every effort to see to it that we organize the digital identity of our citizens. And in so doing, we started by one, putting an enabling environment to see to it that we have legislation that allows for the registration of a citizen. And in that registration, a citizen is assigned a national ID number, a national identification number. Now, that national identification number, we are making it mandatory to access services from the government, that number is a reference tool, and therefore it will become by default, the digital identity of a citizen. We have gone further to request that the players such as MTN indeed do not issue SIM cards for telecommunications unless that number has been registered with a national identification number to ensure that everything you do digitally has a convergence, and that convergence, as far as we are concerned in government of Uganda, would be your national identification number. So your SIM card is linked to that number, and any service therefore that may need to get from government, you would use that number. Now, why that is important, when we were logging in here, there was an authentication where a code is sent to my phone. So we expect that going forward, when citizens apply for a service, to be very sure that the citizen whose name has been entered is indeed the actual one requesting for service, we expect the authentication to be done in that same way. So we are in small ways creating that digital identity for a citizen, and we are putting the necessary infrastructure in place. Like I mentioned earlier, we have set up a government data center. We are now looking to put in place a tier 4 data center for the country to ensure that that data is accessible and in a seamless way, and that citizens can be served faster than before. It is very disappointing for a citizen whose data resides with the government to go to different government agencies and they have to fill forms endlessly, yet you already have my digital identity, or you have the data about me. So it's not fair that when I go to apply for a passport, you still ask me for the data that is already resides with the government. So that's why we are working on, as well as a public infrastructure, to ensure that we operate in a very secure environment and that the data for citizens is not compromised. And in relation to that, we concluded legislation on the Data Protection and Privacy Act. We now have a law. We have finalized the regulations, and we're going to operationalize the Data Protection Office to ensure that citizens, indeed, anybody who collects their data, uses it without offending it.
Jane, did you want to add some thoughts?
Yes, please. Thank you so much, and thank you, Honorable Minister, for that submission. So I would like to add that from a service provider point of view, there's been integrations with the platform that registers digital IDs, whereby, like the Honorable Minister spoke and say that it's mandatory to receive, to buy or register for a SIM card when only you have a national identification number. So this has made the onboarding of customers very easy and fast, because then the two systems speak together. So we are able to integrate, I mean, we're able to verify in real time and have our customers get services in real time as well. We've also integrated with the company registry for corporate organizations that offer advanced services to the end users. So as a corporate organization that would like to use mobile money services or use enterprise services, when they come to us, we're able to validate their registry time. That being said, I know that there's so many other innovations taking place around digital ID. However, I would look at other areas where we can innovate and get better into understanding our customers, plus understanding the market. And one, fraud management. So we know that there's a lot of people who will play games when you have digital payments happening. So how do we use then the digital identity to minimize or limit multiple transactions, especially in an area where you have multiple MNOs operating in one area, where someone can be blocked for fraudulent activity and then they have to obtain a SIM card from another MNO. Secondly, I would look at something that would even improve the digital ID by self-updates, because a lot of people in the population do not have permanent addresses where they reside. So at the point when they're registering for a national ID, they have an address. So how do we allow them to have a self-service where they can actually update their new location, because that is not very sensitive data, as a date of birth or gender or whichever. Some of them are very sensitive, but for certain data can be approved as a self-serve. And then probably consolidating the identities to have one digital wallet, and that the minister has spoken about it as well. That will be a great innovation to have, so that I do not have to walk with my national security card, my national ID, my passport, and different documents at the same time. So can I have a digital wallet where specific data to a service provider is only availed at request and authenticated by the user?
Thank you. So yeah, I mean, a number of important concepts for one of the, you know, fundamental pieces of digital infrastructure that we talk about. I think, you know, one of them is we talked about how we can, when I think on a very macro level, what we're talking about is having a digital economy or a digital system, and then how do physical people interact with it, right? And it's through giving them these digital IDs that allow them to be included into these systems. Now, with that inclusion, you guys are bringing up some important issues like fraud, right? Now we have the potential for digital fraud to occur with that digital identity. We also have the potential to limit some of the fraud that was happening in paper-based ID systems, right? We see this fairly commonly when we are transitioning. I've had some experience in the past, like a Department of Social Welfare, and all of a sudden we realize that the registry of beneficiaries is actually much smaller than we previously thought, when we can assign each one individual digital ID, right? We talked about streamlining this ID between different government ministries, different products and services. So yeah, we don't have to carry around our wallet full of different cards, but we have a singular ID with which we may be able to interact with various different private sector entities or public sector services. We talked about not only having a digital ID for people, but also this concept for companies, for medium and small enterprises, a la kind of a company register. And how does that ID at that level also enable us to provide services to them and have them included more fully in the digital economy? And we talked about, you know, privacy and protection once we are aggregating this data in a centralized fashion to allow all these helpful things like streamlining. Then how do we protect it? How do we enable people to own it and control it in a degree that empowers them and doesn't inhibit them? I've seen, you know, some implications or applications of digital ID with regard to cash and voucher assistance, humanitarian payments. One of the things that has happened over the last several years in Jordan is a digital biometric system has been developed to allow people to then who are receiving cash and voucher assistance to go to a specially fitted ATM, scan their iris or scan their fingerprint, and withdraw money directly from that ATM. So this is a digital ID system that's enabled it. So what it's done is circumvented all the issues we generally have with lost cards, forgotten pins, these types of things, and enabled people to much more fluently interact with the digital technology itself, just using essentially their body. So this is, you know, for KYC purposes and for generally enabling people to interact with the digital economy, with digital systems within it. This is a key kind of foundational component. Beyond digital identity systems, we talk about open payment systems. We talk about connectivity. There's a number of different critical elements of digital infrastructure. Those are probably the three most common we talk about. However, we also note that access to this infrastructure is not equal. And so I wanted to ask you guys about what strategies we can use to extend access to this infrastructure to demographics like women, youth, people in rural areas, elderly, the disabled, refugees, and migrants. So Jane, maybe if I can ask you to start off with some thoughts on that.
Thank you, Mike. So to reference the video from Estonia, we talked, the speaker talked about a lot of social engineering and understanding the needs of people in order to drive adoption. So the different ways in which MTN is extending access to systems and in such different demographics is, first of all, offering services that or products and services that speak to the needs of the people in those areas. And one of the services is ease of payments. So for people to adopt, you have to give them something that improves their life or improves whatever challenges they have in a given community or in a given society. So one of the areas we're looking at is payments for use cases that are digitally enabling, and those are simple micro payments like buying airtime or buying data, because we know that at least 50% of the population in Uganda has a phone. So how do we then enable them to access the services of airtime without moving kilometers away to find a physical location where they have to buy a scratch card? So we enable that using digital payments. But then also, on the other hand, we have to improve phone ownership in households. In rural Uganda, most of the households are led by men. So in most cases, you'll find a man has a handset or a phone, but the woman does not. So they have one phone that they're sharing as a family. However, we try to sensitize the individuals to say, you can have two phones as two individuals, as long as we don't distort the cultural family setting, which comes with the man being the head of the family. Then network access and availability. So we work with development partners as MTN to identify certain areas where they have projects for development that do not have access to the network, that is voice and probably data accessibility. So we build business cases together to drive network access and installations in these places where there is need. We use community influencers as well, because community influencers are trusted people in the community. So trusted people that will adopt a service as early adopters, they become easier influences for other people, especially the women and the children. If you have a woman leader in a market who has adopted to payments or who understands the value attached to digital payments, then you know that the women around her will probably be influenced to pick up the service as well. We do a lot of sensitization in terms of education for financial literacy, because we know that since we are driving a digital agenda of understanding digital payments, there has to come a chance when people understand why digital payments is just, is it just a feel good for MTN? Is it just an agenda for MTN? How does it speak to me as a rural woman who does not even know how to read and write? So we speak about exposing them to credit financing by use of the data that comes out of their transactions that they repeatedly do, and educate them on how to get into the culture of saving and having something that they can consider their own as individuals. We've also enabled digital financing, device financing, which allows women and people in the rural area to own a smartphone at a very subsidized cost. So they pay an upfront payment, but then we allow them to pay for the rest of the balance over a period of either 6 months or 1 year, but they will pay it digitally. In most cases, these women cannot afford to buy a phone upfront, or because we're trying to transition them from a feature phone to a digital phone, we encourage them to have an installment payment that fits within their earnings and also introduce them to a culture of paying digitally. We collaborate a lot, and currently I'm glad to say that the agent network that supports mobile financial services for cash in and cash out, 80% of it is mainly women as handlers, and that is how we're including them into the digital economy to make sure they understand how to do transactions digitally and also influence those that are around them.
Wow. Jane, just to follow up on that, did you say 80% of the cash in, cash out agents for MTN Mobile Money are women? And if so, sorry, go ahead.
Yes, please, as handlers. So 80% of the population that handle the face-to-face interaction with the customer. They might not be the business owners for the mobile money agency, but the person that interacts with customers, 80% of those are women and girls.
That's amazing. Thanks for sharing, and quite unique. And so maybe can you talk about, is that a strategy that MTN employed, or is that something that just evolved on its own?
Part of it is a strategy, and part of it evolved on its own. We've seen a lot of women in Uganda pick up small businesses or want to start small businesses as SMEs or micro enterprises. So that is a cultural thing in terms of involving themselves in economically generating activities. But also we've gone out as an initiative to include women, especially in the rural areas, to deliberately recruit female agents in refugee settlements and certain areas that are not very developed in terms of economic activity, so that we can have them, especially in the market, because if you have a market setting dominated by women selling groceries or foodstuffs, then those are our key potentials for digital onboarding. So what we do when we go to such places, we simply sit with the women and sensitize them and tell them about opportunity of having agency, mobile money agency, as part of their business, so that they can have two sources of economic revenue, but at the same time, we are educating them to understand digital as from a point of start, and as we get into advanced services, it's easier for them to adopt to advanced services after they've started from a micro level.
Mm-hmm. Honorable Bajiri, how do we think about this from a public sector perspective in terms of, you know, providing the private sector and the economy in general with the policy and vision for how the digital economy is going to evolve, and then how the different pieces of the puzzle will fit together to ensure that it's inclusive for some of these marginalized populations?
Thank you very much. And Jen, thanks for that elaborate explanation or submission. And I think what Jen has explained is a testimony that our strategies are working. And the government of Uganda deliberately liberalized the telecom sector and fully liberalized the telecom sector to allow for competition. And by allowing competition, we were looking at consumer protection, but also diversity in terms of services that are being offered by the operators. And indeed, that has been achieved. We have two national telecom operators, MTN being one of them. And indeed, the work that they've been able to do in terms of value-added services is exceptional. But having said that, in our legislation, we deliberately pursued a technology-neutral environment whereby no technology is prescribed. And as a result, we've achieved interoperability from the operators. MTN as an operator, you can send money from MTN to Airtel and vice versa You can send money from two different operators simply because we have put an environment that allows inclusion, and somebody will not be discriminated on account that he subscribed to a certain network and not the other. So in that context, there is indeed a convergence that that we've achieved. But beyond that, we have made policy proposals, and we are saying that indeed to achieve inclusion, because inclusion is at different levels, but there's level of inclusion in the sense that there is no connectivity in a given area. So what we have done, working with the operators again, is to explore certain interventions such as national roaming, where if indeed I traveled in a certain part of the country and there's one network and not the other, the network that is in that place should be able to carry me so that I'm not deprived of the opportunity to have access on account of a particular network not being in that particular place. And that, again, as I mentioned earlier, is in the spirit of encouraging infrastructure sharing and therefore reducing the cost of usage for the citizens in the country. So what Jane has explained really, for us as government, it gives us comfort that our strategies and policies and legislation and all laws are working in the right direction. But beyond that, we have made deliberate efforts to put in place mechanisms to support the underserved areas. And that's the reason why government itself took on the initiative to lay fiber, to make sure that we take connectivity to areas that are underserved. And we have created, I think, in excess of 500 hotspots across the country, where we want the citizens indeed to enjoy the value-added services that the operators are bringing on board, but also the services that government is offering. So there is a complementarity between government and the operators that we think is a good mechanism for us giving services to our citizens.
Honorable Bajie, this is a really interesting concept of the hotspots, the 500 hotspots you have. Can you tell us a little bit more about them, how that works, who manages them, what services they provide?
What we have done is, first of all, we realize that there is a necessity to create demand for the services that the operators are providing. And in so doing, when we lay fiber, we want the citizens to be in position to tap onto the network and be able to access services. Because as I said earlier, we want to automate as much as possible. Now, in the spirit of automation, we think the citizens must have a mechanism and an avenue to indeed utilize our services. So what we have done in Kampala, we have set up a couple of hotspots. And these hotspots fired up from 5:30 every evening and on the weekends from around 1 p.m. And the reason we do that is the capacity that we'll be using in the offices. When we use bandwidth during the day, when we leave offices, it's redundant. So that's the capacity that we are giving to the public to utilize. And indeed, if you came to Kampala and I showed you the hotspots, you would see these border riders converging in given places where they know that there is a free Wi-Fi to go and update their applications, their apps, WhatsApp, name it all, Facebook, and so on in those hotspots. But at the same time, to basically get information, but also access any service that they may need. So our strategy is, if we are out of office and are not using the capacity, and on a public holiday, it's open for the entire day. So what we are doing is that the redundant capacity, when we are out of office, is now given to the community or the public to utilize. as a mechanism of stimulating demand for connectivity.
I love that idea. Harish, can you help bring in some of the global perspective? We've just talked about Uganda from both the private and public sector perspective. What have you seen in other countries in the global south that have led to the advance of this infrastructure being more inclusive for these demographics?
Thank you. It was very, very interesting to hear the experience of Uganda from Jane and also the Honorable Secretary. I will step back a little bit and talk firstly on the universal ensuring that the ID infrastructure is universal. No? There are also in many countries there are also exclusions related to that, and incidentally, this was one of the themes in the of a hackathon which the World Bank had launched as part of the annual meetings just a few months back. We called it the Mission Billion, to how do we reach the billion who currently do not have some kind of a legal identification. And the there were two finalists who specifically addressed this particular point, and I thought it would be useful to illustrate that. The first one was about targeting the intellectually challenged in Nigeria. And the solution they were proposing was to bring in a broad kind of more civic society engagement, creating some kind of a civic organization which will help facilitate the access to ID for segments which are unable to access it by themselves. And this kind of goes to show the power of civil society engagement with them can help in bridging some of the exclusionary gaps we can see. The other one was a service called Mobile Wani, which is a service from an Indian company. And they were looking at providing information through a voice channel, right? There's one of the reasons for exclusion is also a lack of information and lack of familiarity. And these are the two main reasons why there's also a lot of exclusion. And this seeks to address both of them by making it more easy to access the information and kind of also to address any grievances they have. And in some sense, putting it, making it much more easier for them to access and interact with the provision of service. So that was on the specifically on the ID side. Now, in terms of the payment services and the digital payments infrastructure in general, the big development we have been seeing in the last few years is what is being called as fast payments. In some countries, they call it real-time retail payments, and some others call it instant payments. But basically, all of them are effectively trying to simulate a cash-like experience in terms of immediacy of the payment. And then also wide access and more convenient access. And this is enabling to take the digital payments to segments where it is difficult to service using the existing technologies, existing approaches, because of the cost structure, and then because of the way the transactions are processed, et cetera. So, and this uses, for example, QR codes to replace kind of POS infrastructure. It replaces kind of it brings in small micro merchants who are able to accept digital payments and also make digital payments. And incidentally, during the COVID crisis, in some countries we saw the street hawkers also being given QR codes to make it easier for them to continue to serve in a contactless manner in terms of at least the payments part, right? Of course, this technology is created in a way. Also, it has to be created in a way that all the different providers in the country are able to access it. And as the Honorable Secretary was mentioning, the interoperability has a very strong linkage with inclusion in terms of being able to include different providers who can then provide services to their customers in a more inclusive manner. So that means that it's not just banks, it's not just a particular type of payment service providers, but anybody who is licensed and allowed to offer that particular service in the country should be able to interact with that. And there are also new means of interaction which are coming up using open APIs. A good example of that is, of course, the PSD2 in the case of Europe, where they allowed third-party providers to be able to access the infrastructure and provide services to the customers, of course, based on the consent of the customer. And this has been implemented in very different ways in many countries. And what that enables is that if a person is more convenient with a WhatsApp or any other local application, and they are carrying out much of their digital lives in that, then they can use the same thing to also interact on the payment side. And they might still maintain an account with a particular bank or a particular mobile money service provider, but they're no longer restricted to the interfaces that entity provides. So then now they have a much more open range of providers through whom they can access. So that can also be extremely powerful, very liberating, and in a way it can also support the integration and interoperability by allowing interoperability not just at the level of the infrastructure, but also at the level of the end device and also the end app. You know? So kind of it takes it to the next level. So I would think those are the key developments. And then one fundamental point really is about inclusion, is about being able to tailor the products to meet the needs of the particular segments of the of customers. And if you look at the FinTechs data, which is the survey which is done by the World Bank every 3 years, we ask a question: why is it that you do not have an account, or why are you not included? And there are various reasons, like I don't have enough money, and so on. And one of them is that I don't need it because a family member already has it. And this goes to the point which Jane was making earlier, that typically households might feel that if one person has an account, then that is adequate. But that is perhaps because the use cases have not been developed for all the other members of the household. So even if a youth in the household who's not employed, who's going to college, they will still have expenses related to transit and so on, and also maybe to online courses. So they also have payment needs. And if you have to decide, you have to develop payment services and mechanisms in a way that it meets their needs as well. No? So I think it's also about tailoring the product, tailoring how it is delivered, and also the different transaction channels which I enable. Thank you.
Thank you. The expertise on this panel is evident. We have just touched on a lot of really important demographics. We had the example of including women as agents in Uganda, the example of extending connectivity to rural and low income people through hotspots, the example of really including youth in the digital economy through hackathons. Right, the digital economy, we talk about it is one of the largest places for employment in the new economy as we move forward. In a country like Uganda, I think the median age is 15. So ensuring that youth are included in the digital era is paramount. A number of other important concepts we discussed. Is the concept of kind of infrastructure as stacked or layered, right? And so, once we put down one foundational piece, maybe most foundational, something like extending electricity, grid electricity, then on top of that, maybe we can build a digital identity system, right? We see this with the progression in India, the Aadhaar ID system, and then building the unified payments interface, the UPI, on top of that. And Jane gave a good example in Uganda of using what is now fairly ubiquitous, mobile money. And the last national demand side survey in 2017, the World Bank did, Uganda and Kenya were the only two countries in the world that had over 50% of the population using mobile money. So Uganda is one of the two leading countries, and it's now ubiquitous enough that they can build a Paygo Energy or a Paygo smartphone product on top of that. So essentially what's happening is a SIM card or some communication chip is put in that, that smartphone. And because that person has access to mobile money to make payments on that smartphone, they don't have to go to a bank or anywhere. They can do it directly from their phone. And so that unlocks the ability to do financing and to give people smartphones with small regular payments as opposed to a large lump sum that's much harder to put together. I think our definition of what's foundational infrastructure is changing. For some people, you know, looking at hardware like smart devices may or may not be. To me, it's central, even though it's not fixed in the sense that infrastructure or the definition of infrastructure may have been in the past. But again, you know, that ability for people to be included into that digital infrastructure or economy is predicated on their ability to interact with it through these smart devices. The last concept that all of you touched on was this concept of connectivity, interoperability. Harish, you talked about open APIs. And I just wanted to do a follow-up on that because it's really central to foundational infrastructure. And I wanted to see if you guys had comments on the sequencing of it, because that's one of the hardest things to get right. And so on the one hand, if there is not interoperability, what happens is a business case can be created for a single entity to invest and capture a market, right? And so it creates a business case for investment where a large business with capital can invest and develop a competitive advantage that then captures a market. And so, you know, I think the classic example of that is Safaricom, M-Pesa in Kenya, that were able to become so dominant that they really captured the mobile money market. But that can stymie ecosystem development, right? Having competition and other smaller players involved in the market. And so, you know, there may be issues if we introduce interoperability too early, or we might say that, hey, look, we have to introduce it early to dictate how the market evolves. But we need to do it in a certain way to ensure that investment still happens. So I don't know, maybe Jane, can I ask you, do you have thoughts on how we sequence this correctly so private sector interests are protected as well as the development of the market in general?
So the way I see how to sequence that is, first of all, having an enabling environment. And enabling environment comes by support of government to drive certain initiatives that speak to financial inclusion. And like the Honorable Minister spoke, he spoke a lot about the government being involved in and having a strategy that they're driving that is definitely mirrored into the private sector initiatives. But also to look at supporting the connectivity rails as businesses start to evolve, and things like open API and product development, and allowing developers to ride on a platform and enable services that reach the bottom of the pyramid in real time without having to have a private sector organization invest so much in resource of reaching the end user, but rather working from a collaborative, inclusive front where both of them come together and they have a strategy to drive, but also are mindful of what the economy or the end users are interested in holistically. And I see Open API as a very key platform to enable that, but also enterprise as a service, having enabled commercial data centers in the country. I know that MTN has one where people can store data in the country and not have it outside the country so they can easily access it, having messaging as a service, a free service that can be accessed by all people so that there's a collaboration from all fronts, from private sector and government.
Thank you, Jane. And Harish, what about the international experience? How have you seen the sequencing done of opening up or interconnecting these systems that's worked?
This is actually a very, very difficult decision, right? And as you rightly alluded to in your remarks about the tension between doing it too early versus doing it too late, and getting it just right, I think it is very, very difficult. And I think also the point about anything in the digital economy is not just about that there have to be multiple providers. There are certain natural monopolies in some of these because the benefits of economies of scale and scope. There are natural tendencies for the winner takes all and kind of monopoly power coming in. I think from a public policy perspective, what is important is to keep the market contestable, right? Going back to the experience in Uganda, which was narrated by the Honorable Secretary, when a new telecom provider comes in, they are required to interconnect with the other provider, and the existing incumbent is required to open it up. No? So it's not about it's mandated, no? So they have to open up access. So that's an example of keeping the market contestable, right? In the case of mobile money services and payment services in particular, when telecom companies offer these services, there are certain they control the transaction channel, so they have some ability to exert their power and kind of in some sense stop other providers from entering the market or offering the service in an efficient manner through access to USSDs, et cetera. So keeping those transaction channels available to all eligible providers in the country is also another policy decision which we have seen. In terms of requiring everybody to connect onto one particular system, become interoperable for transactions, et cetera, I think that's a second order of business, right? So I think first you need to get more providers into the market and give them enough space for them to be able to execute on their business plans. And at some point, I think it's very important, of course, for interoperability to come in terms of transactions. We have seen in some contexts this kind of coming in on its own from the private sector side. And the experience in the previous years with the card industry also shows that the Visa, MasterCard evolved as an initiative in the private sector to interoperate, right? Become interoperable. And we also see in the telecom sector with respect to tower sharing, et cetera, automatically evolving as a particular business grows, right? But there are contexts in which this might not happen, right? And that's where the public authorities have to come in, have to step in, bring everybody together, and kind of create this infrastructure through a public initiative, right? It doesn't have to be publicly owned, but maybe the initial impetus has to come from the public sector. But the impetus is coming from the public sector, I think it's very important to engage the private sector on critical decisions, in particular in terms of course, the technical design, et cetera, but also in terms of pricing, right? Yeah. The interoperability doesn't mean that you're offering it free. You know? The provider whose infrastructure is being used has to be compensated. Otherwise, it creates perverse incentives, and you might see that an entity might come into the market and do free ride on the investments made by other providers, right? So I think you need to also prevent against free riding. So there has to be some kind of a business model behind it. And all of this is perhaps best left to the private sector to evolve in terms of what is the pricing mechanism for the interoperable transactions and what transactions should ideally be interoperable. So it is not fair, for example, to ask an agent of a particular mobile money provider to also offer account opening services for another provider. That simply doesn't work in the commercial sense. And if you draw a parallel to the world of ATMs, you can go to an ATM and withdraw, you can use any of the bank's card and withdraw money, but you can't get the marketing services and other services which are offered by the bank which installed the ATM, right? So I think being conscious of that, being able to being involved in the private sector to ensure that the business interests are protected, but also the service availability improves for the public at large, right? So I think that is a difficult balance to achieve, and this can only come by the public and private cooperation. So I hope I answered that, and maybe two additional points. Maybe one is about the access to infrastructure, right? So one has to look at this as a long running innings, right? So it's not about one innings and everything is sorted out and that's it. No, it's, life is good all along after that. So I think this thing evolves in phases. So you might achieve one level of competition and interoperability at one given stage, But when new players come into the market, the entities which control that infrastructure now, they might become, they might start behaving in a way to block the new entrants, right? So you need to constantly monitor the access policies of infrastructure. You need to constantly monitor the state of competition in the market, and public policies might have to come in to require access to certain infrastructure being opened up. And then also by the central bank, for example, by offering access to the services it offers, automatically also creates a pressure on the market, makes it more competitive. So these are some of the experiences we are seeing. Then, of course, I don't want to take you into a different direction with talking about central bank digital currencies, etc. That is also, in a way, a pressure point to force the industry to become more interoperable and so on. Thank you.
Thank you, Harish. Honorable Bajiri, I think, you know, if we create a false dichotomy from a public sector perspective, on one end of the dichotomy, people might say, hey, look, it's, or might have the philosophy that the public sector should have a command approach to interoperability or interconnectivity, and say, you know, hey, look, if you go tell Jane to open up and share her agents with Airtel, it's not going to happen. Those guys are competitors. Or if you make the same analog with, you know, banks sharing ATMs, something like that, right? And you really need to go tell them to do it and enforce it. On the other end of the spectrum, now we have digital companies that are open API first, right? We have Shopify and e-commerce, we have Stripe and FinTech, and their whole business model is to provide that interconnectivity because they think it creates a better customer experience. It enables new businesses to be grown on top of it and in a sense become part of that digital infrastructure. And so on the other side of the spectrum, we say, no, look, hey, there's a business case for it because it creates a better customer experience. And as policymakers, we should you know, have a light touch and let the digital economy evolve as it does. So my question to you, Honorable Bajiri, is how do we find a happy middle point? How do we find a hybrid approach between those two ends of the spectrum?
Well, I was laughing when Harish was making his presentation. And indeed, yeah, as he said, it's not as easy as it may sound. But indeed, what we do is we have our hands off and our eyes on in the operations of the private sector, just to ensure that the sector indeed does grow. But what we have done is within the regulatory framework, we have prescribed a mechanism for interconnection and interconnection at a number of levels. But having said that, indeed it is true the big operators reluctantly entertain the small players in a given segment. And I can talk about financial services in this respect. You will find that there is a small player who indeed may want to actively participate, but perhaps they want to ride on these big numbers that the national telecom operators have. And therefore, it makes a lot of sense for them to connect. It's more beneficial to them to connect. And the big players are saying, wait a minute, I've invested in all this infrastructure over the years. I can't open it up for you to just come with zero investment, to just come and ride on this sort of infrastructure. Having said that, so it's a bit, on the one hand, we want the small enterprises to also thrive, but at the same time, we recognize that the big players have indeed put in a lot of resources in terms of investment. So, we encourage dialogue, the regulator for telecom, in our case, the Uganda Communications Commission, at times facilitates dialogue to see to it that these entities are supported by the big players, because it's the only way they can be productive in an economy. Otherwise, if indeed you wanted to play a role in financial services and you won't have access to the telecom operator, then you have no business case. So we facilitate dialogue, and I think we've succeeded in some instances to sit with the small players, have a go or have a chance in collaboration with the big players. But in saying that, it's extremely regulation and legislation in the digital economy is extremely hard, because the innovation comes first and then we follow with legislation and trying to organize how this should be regulated. Mobile money is a classic example. It all started very, very fast, and then we came from behind to see how do we regulate, how do we legislate in this fast and productive and very useful platform that the public wants. There were areas that were quite disturbing. I mean, we kept asking ourselves, now the people who have died and had money on their phones, what happens? In a banking environment, you have a next of kin, they have a register, and so on and so forth. So we came from behind to try and regulate. So likewise, on the issue of open APIs and so on and so forth, we hold a view that as time goes on, we shall perfect a mechanism of providing guidance in that particular respect.
Thank you. And we now only have about 3 minutes left. But Harish, I just wanted to ask you just shortly, given our time, to focus on FinTech, because the Singapore FinTech Festival, and what you've seen in the global south in terms of which countries are leading in terms of creating an enabling environment, a foundational infrastructure for FinTech, and what can we learn from them? Maybe choose one example.
Thank you, Mike. No, it's kind of, it's not fair to say which countries are leading and so on. So I think each country is doing its best given its particular context. I would rather speak in terms of some of the trends we are seeing. As I was mentioning, kind of the digital capabilities for ID, fast payment services, open APIs, and then also leveraging the power of alternative data. Is basically where the whole industry is moving, and different countries are in different stages. And what is very interesting is it is very difficult to say that this is if you don't have this, you cannot do it, right? And for example, people might say that, well, if you don't have a fully functioning digital ID, you cannot have financial inclusion. But that's not the case. And they take the case of Uganda, where they achieved quite a bit of progress on financial inclusion with ID, but not necessarily with all the full digital capabilities, right? But of course, to go to the next level, you might need other capabilities to come in. So I think people are finding ways around it. But fundamentally, I think this key points are about how do we make payments faster? How do we make it easier for individuals to transact? How do we make it easier for people to remotely authenticate? And then also about how do we leverage the data which is coming in because of all these digital interactions to make available other financial services and also other digital services. So I think I would leave it at that, Mike. Thank you.
Perfect. Thank you, Harish. And thank you to all our distinguished panelists. We now are out of time, but I want to thank you guys for an incredibly engaging discussion, and encourage everyone to enjoy the rest of Singapore FinTech Festival. I'll sign off now with the rest of the panelists, and one last time.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.